moratorium given by the Government of India on the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code or IBC expired this week. In simple terms, from March 2020, when the country went into a lockdown, to now, if a company defaulted on its loan or payments, the bank, lending institution or even a supplier could not initiate any action against the defaulting company or take the company to court to recover its dues. What this moratorium did was, it gave companies struggling under a COVID setback a breather. Now with it expired, today on the Property Show, we are asking a basic question. Is this good news or not for India Inc., especially for the cash-starved real estate projects where home buyers are stuck? Joining me on the show, Sumant Batra, Managing Partner at Kesar Das B & Associates and insolvency lawyer of international repute. We also have with us Rohit Gera. He's the Managing Director of Gera Development. Sunil Rohakale, Managing Director and CEO of ASK Investment Managers. And Hardeep Sachdeva, Partner at AZB and Partners. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me. I'm going to start by asking Sumant, because he's the insolvency expert here. Non-extension or moratorium, is this good news or bad news for India Inc.?
Well, I think personally it is something which is very welcome. I feel that this is something which should have happened earlier. It's coming a bit too late. You know, my personal view is that we can't be two opinions that we needed a moratorium to give a temporary respite to the industry, to give them time to stabilize their businesses, start negotiating with the lenders how a restructuring could take place. It has caused a big disruption in the insolvency industry, which was at a very nascent stage, and we had put in so much of effort, political will, might, energy, effort to put together a world-class insolvency industry, which was starting to show green shoots, but suddenly this disruption has happened, and this has really caused big setbacks. The other concern is that whether this has really brought in any major relief to the industry, because we haven't really seen all this relief of time translating into something more concrete, formidable benefit, which they would be able to build on or capitalize or make use of now that the moratorium has been lifted. I still feel that it might just end up kicking the can down the lane.
Rohit, someone said yes, it was much needed, but what started out as a three-month moratorium got extended to a whole year. Do you believe we needed something that long, and agree with Sumant that we've just kicked the can further down the road?
Well, Manisha, I think there's a yes and no kind of answer to that. The yes, because we did it is because if you look at some markets, Maharashtra, for example, when the government came up with stamp duty benefit in the two-tiered manner that they did, this has generated sales, this has generated revenue, and this has really helped the fortunes of a large number of developers.
Mm-hmm.
There are other states that have followed suit, and therefore, to that extent, you know, giving the moratorium period and then coming up with ways to help the developers and to help the industry exit from the challenging circumstances that they were facing, it's certainly a good thing. If for example, if the moratorium had ended 6 months ago and you didn't have these you know, the booster shot, if you will, to the industry, you'd just end up with many more developers going under, and that doesn't serve any purpose, because it's not getting people their homes by a developer going, you know, into insolvency proceedings. So I think to that extent, yes. To the extent where developers have the wrong product, the wrong developer, bad practices from the past, it's just given them life for a little bit longer. They continue to be in the ICU, or, you know, the pulling the plug is a matter of time. We've only deferred the pulling of the plug. In overall, I think the benefits that we've seen with a large number of developers who've seen positive sales, net-net, I think it was a good call in hindsight to do the whole 12-month moratorium period.
Sunil, now what happens? I mean, in the sense that, okay, so Maharashtra has got some bit of leeway because of the stamp duty reduction, sales have boosted up, but that's not an all-India situation. There seems to be a lot more distress in North, NCR especially. What happens to cash-strapped developers? Because earlier, it was, you know, you knew who the stronger ones were. In this 1 year, everyone's got shelter.
No, I completely agree. I think the industry have seriously gone through a major flux. and the industry has not gone into the major flux because of pandemic, but industry has gone into major flux and this asset liability mismatch on poor sales, cash trappedness, and no further credit available to this industry since September 18. This particular situation, before it goes out of hand, I think what is most important is the developer. What is most important is the customer, and what is most important is the lender. So I think developer's approach and mindset towards resolution and coming to a solution of these current problems on hand is very vital. Customer has to bring in the collaborative skills, and as far as the lender is concerned, he has to find out an innovative structuring so that this at least ensures the completion of the homes are on the visible path. The customers do keep paying the further money, the lenders get their portion, and hopefully the developer also gets something in the journey. But all if right. there is anybody who does not follow the same path, I think what probably has come to end is going to be even much more murky and ugly.
Wow, so you're saying that things could actually get much murkier, Hardeep. You know, taking any other industrial company or any other manufacturing company to insolvency is very different from taking a real estate company to insolvency, because there are home buyers involved here. And therefore, there was also, you know, some changes brought in into the act to protect home buyers' interest. If Sunil is saying now the Pandora's box will open up, the weak developers are probably going to be revealed to everybody and will need either go to insolvency or will need a lot of help. How do you see the situation?
So I can tell you one thing, that there cannot be a cast in stone application to real estate industry, especially the sector where the developers are in the residential or housing sector. The insolvencies are not just initiated by the lenders. In this sector, the customers are treated as the financial creditors, and therefore they can also initiate the similar insolvency against the developer company. Now, two things are going on, or two things have happened. One is, because of these COVID delays, the lockdown may be for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 months, but the consequential delays in the completion or the construction status of the projects have now led to more than 1 to 2 years. Therefore, the customers will not get their houses on time, and the delays could be far more than as expected. Number one. Number two, as of now, no regulatory authority, including RERA or consumer forums, are showing any kindness while they are granting the compensation to the home buyers, or granting the interest or the refund, you know, awards to the home buyers when it comes to the delays by the developers. And therefore, the number of cases by the home buyers against the developers and the resultant insolvencies will only shoot up. Mm-hmm. And I think there is right now a time for these developers to consolidate, to come back to the level where they want to be before this can be lifted.
Sunil, what about, during the pandemic, we've also seen another trend, at least in NCR, the stronger developers are overtaking the weaker developers. And Prestige was in news, Brookfield has been in news, there's also Mixun Group, which has taken over Ansal IT, City Parks. Do you think more than insolvency, that could be a better route, just a shakeout in the stronger developers taking over the weaker projects? The consumer or the customer has the highest chances of getting his home?
See, that is what I said, ki there are developers who have established brands, have shown the execution capabilities, and wherever these execution capabilities and the governance exist, those developers are supported by the lenders, the private equity guys, and the money is available. The ones who are basically small and medium types, who probably are stuck, they cannot raise any more further capital. I think in that situation, the lenders are actually forcing them. Customer pressure is forcing them to really do some kind of resolution by which handing over these projects to a large developer who has a brand, who can able to complete. The moment you have action on the side, the completion is in foresight, I think the new customers and the old customers are wholeheartedly supporting. Question here is the kind of capital required for this industry to come back with full execution throttling. SWAMIH fund alone is not sufficient, and I think that's a big challenge. The challenge here is that there are good developers are willing to take over the projects and complete it, but there has to be a mechanism which IBC at this point of time has given some protection or some kind of structure to Swami Fund, but the same structure is not applicable to other NBFCs and private equity funds in case the project still goes into the insolvency bucket. So I think there is a good news. At the same time, there is some work to be done.
There's a lot of work to be done. Sumanth, I'm going to go toss back to you. So one, when the floodgates open on the companies which are now taken to NCLT, how will NCLT handle it?
I have two concerns. My first concern is that we don't have the capacity at the moment in the NCLT to be able to deal with any additional number of cases coming in. We are already struggling quite badly in terms of the cases that are already pending. There are resolution plans that have been approved a year ago, 1.5 to 2 years ago, which have not been approved by the NCLT, and that's largely because they have already overburdened with the cases, and to expect them to deal with another huge stream of cases coming in will just be expecting too much out of them. And I would have thought that the government would have used this period to put in another 60 to 70 members, additional benches, and be ready. The billion-dollar question that I might ask myself is that what has changed dramatically for those companies that were on the verge of knocking the doors of IBC? Not themselves, perhaps by some of the stakeholders. Has anything changed? I mean, where is the guarantee or immunity that they will not end up in the insolvency now? And therefore, how would they have benefited in this one year, or except that some may have delivered part of the project, some home buyers may have bought some units, but it may still end up being an insolvency, undoing all the good work that may have been done in this period.
There was JP Infratech, which was actually resolved by IRP. The project was handed over or awarded to NBCC for completion. And yet, you had a Supreme Court ruling, which actually has set aside the resolution plan, which was approved by 97.36 of the Committee of Creditors. Now, what happens in this case? That was the only real estate company which actually made to the headlines of insolvency because of 20,000 stuck buyers.
The issue is that JP raised very complex questions of law by the sheer nature of the scale of and the complexity of that project. And what the Supreme Court has done, it has decided some very, very important questions of law, which are not relevant only for the JP case, but for the real estate sector at large, and for IBC in general. And having done that, they realized that in the light of the clarity of these issues, we need to resolve some commercial issues which have remained unanswered and which the NCLT could not have or did not. And therefore, they have relegated the matter back for a 45-day short period for the COC to consider this trial plan afresh, keeping in mind the decisions that the Supreme Court has given. So I think at the end of the day, JP will only benefit from all this, although the delay might have frustrated some stakeholders.
You said 45 days. That is the kind of time frame that the Supreme Court has given. But Sumanth, can I really expect both NBCC and Suraksha to come up with their fresh plans in 2 weeks? I mean, the asset has been lying. Nothing's happening on those projects for almost more than a year. Will they be ready, and will this get over in 45 days?
It happened last time also, Supreme Court gave 45 days only. So when in the earlier round, also Supreme Court gave 45 days.
So you're confident, Sumanth, that they will be, both these companies will be able to prepare their fresh plans in 15 days, 2 weeks?
I can't comment on that, but what I can really say is that if they do submit their plan within the time which the Supreme Court has granted, we will be able to complete the process in 45 days as we did last time. Everybody is mindful that we need to work on fixed timelines. We will work 24/7 to make this happen. And I'm sure everybody is looking forward to that.
All right. Thank you, Sumanth, Rohit and Sunil for your insights. When we come back, we get to the other side of the story of the 20,000 home buyers of JP Infratech projects like Wishtown, Cosmos Classic, who have been stuck. Now, why are they feeling deeply let down? But obviously, hearing Sumanth, they might get some of their confidence back. Stay with us.